Campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.
Lee Snodgrass-Appleton is a Democratic candidate in the 57th Assembly District. Lee, welcome back to Wisconsin Eye.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Just an overview. What do you consider your top campaign issue, Lee?
Well, I don't want to be redundant to 2018 when I ran, but it's still healthcare. In fact, I think the COVID-19 crisis has really shown a spotlight on how dependence on healthcare through our employer is really putting a lot of people at risk, especially now when we're seeing a lot of people lose their jobs. And that intersects with how we impact people going back to schools, how we're dealing with childcare. So really the overarching umbrella is still healthcare.
Thanks. Let's talk about that pandemic a bit with three questions. The first one is, as you're aware, some Senate Republicans, state Senate Republicans, want to come in and rescind the governor's statewide mask edict. Do you support that mask edict?
Very much so. I mean, it's evidence-based, certainly. And I think people forget that it's not only protecting us from a health standpoint, but it's protecting us from an economic standpoint, because the sooner that we can get the spread of the virus under control, the sooner we can safely get people back to work and into restaurants and businesses, and we can get children back into school. I live in Appleton, and Appleton just made the New York Times as the number 11 city in the nation that has the highest spread of the virus right now. I think we really need to make sure that we're just applying good old-fashioned discipline. You know, we're just going to take a few weeks of doing the right thing for ourselves and our neighbors, and we can be on the path to recovery both health-wise and economic-wise.
Let's talk about hospitals, which are on the front line, Wisconsin and nationally, of treating COVID-19 patients. If you're in the Assembly voting on the next state budget, do hospitals deserve an even greater priority than they might have in the current budget?
I think so. I mean, obviously, hospitals have taken a tremendous hit, especially during safer at home orders. And even now, there are people who are postponing routine procedures or elective surgeries. That's obviously hitting the bottom line of hospitals. I don't think in the middle of a global health pandemic, we want to get into a situation where we're looking at hospitals or care centers that are closing, especially in some of our rural communities where, you know, there aren't a lot of other options. So I think we do need to make sure that we're making that a priority in the state budget.
Last week, State Senator Chris Cappinga filed a bill that says if you're a business or an organization, and if you try to comply with COVID-19 protocols to protect your employers and customers, you couldn't be sued over COVID-19. Do we need that state law?
You know, I'm really uncomfortable with blanket laws, blanket statements like that anyway. I don't think that we should legislate due process. I think that it's up for the judicial system and the courts to decide if somebody has enough evidence to prove negligence, whether they claim it or not. Those things, I think, are best fought out in the courts rather than us preventing somebody who might have a real case from being able to get their due diligence. So I would not support that.
The state budget, let's talk about that. There was a report last week that tax collections held up in the year that ended June 30. But we don't know yet whether the pandemic is going to cut tax collections in the current year, which ends next June 30. If we're a billion short, do we cut spending? Do we raise taxes or fees?
You know, it's really, really difficult to say one or the other. I mean, it would be easy to say one or the other, wouldn't it? My concern is that right now we're at a point where the services, the essential services that so many people rely on, would be in danger of being cut. It's also concerning when you think about, you know, people who are already working with very limited household budgets about, you know, raising that tax on their household in some way or another. So I think we need to look at it really carefully and say, okay, we're in a time when government, actually our job is to provide and make sure that the people of Wisconsin are healthy, safe, employed, doing well. So we need to really look at very carefully what it means if we cut anything. And we want to make sure that we're not cutting what people need. And I would say that, therefore, where does the money come from, right? You know, where is it going to come from if you're not raising taxes and you're not cutting? First and foremost, Medicaid expansion. I mean, the you know, the the Joint Finance Committee cut $1 billion of revenue from the governor's budget. You know, Medicaid expansion was part of it. Part of it was some of those loopholes, like I talked about in my last election, the dark store loophole. Some of it is tax breaks to profitable corporations. And some of it, frankly, was just rejecting, the ability to tax wealth at the same rate of actually somebody working at a job. So I do think we can find money if we look at some of those solutions.
Well, I noticed on your website that you advocate legalizing both medical and recreational marijuana. In fact, you call marijuana, quote, less harmful than alcohol, close quote. Do you see legalizing marijuana as a major source of state revenue then?
I do. I actually think, I remember tweeting about it early on in the pandemic that now would be a great time to have a conversation about legalization. I think we do need to take it in phases and be smart and have it be based on research. And obviously, if we legislate it, we can put regulations and rules around it. First and foremost, medical marijuana, the very least we can do for somebody who is in chronic pain or end of life care is to provide that relief. Personally, I lost my father in December. I spent the month of November watching him in hospice slowly decline, and that would have been a wonderful option to relieve pain for him and others like him. And then when it comes to recreational, I always joke at that term. I don't think of it as recreational per se. It's something that we need to take seriously. I mean, alcohol is a serious issue in our state. I want to make sure that we're putting parameters around it so that we keep people safe. But yeah, I think both of those things really, I mean, it would be an economic driver. We only have to look to our neighbors literally surrounding us about how the income that they've had come in from legalization to see that this is a smart choice economically for Wisconsin.
The debate in the Capitol over who should draw the next set of congressional and legislative district lines. Constitution says the party in power. The governor says a People's Maps Commission. What's your position on redistricting?
Well, actually, I think the People's Maps Commission works within the constitutional process. I mean, the People's Maps Commission is really just to gather the people who, frankly, have the most to gain and the most to lose to be part of that process actively. And then those recommendations then go to the legislator per the Constitution. Now, I'd love to trust the legislator. I don't personally think they did it right when they did it behind closed doors with lawyers and high-paid lobbyists and secrecy oaths the last time. I'd love to trust the Democrats who are going to be elected to be fair. But I think that People's Maps provides a really great recommendation for us to go on. We know that I think it's 52 of 72 Wisconsin counties have already passed either resolutions or referendums that are advisory that says, hey, we want fair maps. And speaking as somebody who is in what's considered one of Wisconsin's safe districts, gerrymandered to favor a Democrat, I have no problem fighting for those votes. I want to get back to a point where I and others like me have to be accountable to the electorate.
Okay, let's talk about property taxes. We're a high property tax state. As a result, school districts and local governments have lived with caps and limits on property taxes for more than 20 years. If you're in the assembly voting on the next state budget, should we continue those caps and limits on property tax levies?
You know, this is a huge question, and I'm partnered with a county board member, friends with a number of county board members and municipal leaders. I think levy limits are just that. I think they are limits on what local government can do. I think we need to get back to a point where we're, trusting the local governments, the boards, the executives to make decisions that are right for their community. So I would be in support of removing those caps so that they can do that. Now, the fear, of course, is are property taxes going to skyrocket? Are they going to abuse that? Actually, I think if you look, it's most municipalities were, working in a very austere budget, and they were capped at a rate that was incredibly low, and they've been limited ever since. I think it's a lot easier to get out a county board member than it is a state legislator. And if you don't like what they're doing with your taxes, you can vote them out pretty quickly and pretty easily. So I'd like to put that control back into local hands and see if they can find other creative sources of funding so they're not so reliant on property taxes.
So you'd be willing to let local governments give them the tools to adopt alternative sources of revenue. Milwaukee County perhaps wants to adopt a half-cent sales tax, so they should have new revenue options?
Yeah, in fact, let's look at Outagamie County. So Outagamie County passed a half-percent sales tax actually right before the pandemic. Now, obviously, they didn't have the foresight to know that was coming, but thank goodness they did pass it. Their reason for doing it was a couple of things: to pay down their bond, to pay down debt. They believe they saved $3 to $4 million in bonding, which, you know, avoids potential tax hikes in the future. Also, they wanted to lower property taxes, and they wanted to provide additional income for school districts. So I think that there can be good things that come from that. And again, we elect those local leaders to make those decisions.
The debate in the Capitol over police reforms is playing out in three ways. The governor called a special session. He and Lieutenant Governor Barnes have a nine-bill package. Speaker Voss is creating a task force. In the Senate, State Senator Van Wongard has his own bills. What police reforms do you support?
You know, I support the package that was recommended by the Legislative Black Caucus. I certainly support, I actually took a little bit of a look at the Republican bills, and I think there's a lot of similarities. So I think that there's a point to start having conversation. I think we've got two packages of bills that say a lot of the same thing, and I don't think we need a task force right now to start moving forward on discussions on those. The thing about the task force that concerns me is I think it causes greater delay at a point where, you know, how many more lives are going to be lost. I do also want to say that I reached out, I've been a participant in Black Lives Matter rallies. I'm certainly a Black Lives Matter supporter, but I also reached out to our local police chief, and I had a meeting with him, and we discussed the issues and the problems, and we discussed some of those bills that he does support. And he reminded me that, you know, training, like we want to have implicit bias training and things in some of these bills, that comes out of their operations budget. So, you know, defunding the police is something that people like to throw around. I think we need to really look at what that means in terms of if we would like to have certain trainings, implicit bias trainings throughout the state, harm reduction trainings, use of force trainings, we need to fund that. So that's another example of if we want something, the state needs to provide those funds so that it doesn't get cut and we are guaranteed that we have safe policing procedures. And one more thing, if I may.
Please.
I think that policing reform is not limited to law enforcement. I think we need to look at our entire criminal justice system. I did a ride along with a lieutenant, and at the end of that ride along, he said to me, "Lee, was there anything here today that I could have solved? Is there a problem here that I could have solved?" And the answer was no. It was related to home insecurity. It was related to poverty. It was related to mental health access. It was related to addiction counseling. These are the things that we need to fund more so that the police are not going on calls like this and they're dealing truly with solving crimes and protecting.
The governor last year recommended raising the gas tax to stabilize how we pay for highways and bridges. It's 30.9 cents, hasn't been raised in 10 or 12 years. Could you vote for a gas tax increase?
I would vote for one that was indexed to inflation and tied to fuel consumption. I don't think it's radical. You know, this was something that was supported on a bipartisan measure for decades and decades ago. And I think getting back there is smart. I would want to make sure that those funds are tied to actual road maintenance and repairs and are not diverted anywhere else. But I think it's, you know, I really don't think it's all that controversial if you look at the history of our state and how we handle that.
One more new subject. If a school district or local government plans a major public works project, should they have to give a preference to Wisconsin businesses? The reason I ask is a study said in 2015, out-of-state contractors on public works projects got contracts that totaled $72 million, but that went up to $146 million in 2018. Local governments have to give a preference to Wisconsin businesses?
Absolutely. If you are spending taxpayer dollars, I want you to be spending them on Wisconsin businesses and workers. I think this makes perfect sense. Why would you give an opportunity for money to go out of state, whether it's on the business or the contract that you're paying to that business or to the worker? They're going to spend that in their families and their community. There's a ripple effect. I think the end of project labor agreements was harmful for the state of Wisconsin for a number of reasons. So I would like to get back to a point where we are indeed supporting Wisconsin work in Wisconsin for jobs, especially that are funded by taxpayers.
Last question. Differences between you and your opponent on November 3, please.
Well, I think I bring a unique perspective in the sense that I have worked in the private sector. I've owned my own business. For years I had my own marketing consulting company, and now I work for a nonprofit. So I'm used to working in very different arenas, and I'm used to working, especially in my nonprofit way, with an austere budget, budget austerity. I'm used to being answered to by the public. You know, obviously, I work for a nonprofit, and our money is funded by public dollars, and that's what, you know, you do in the legislature. And I think finding the best return on investment, making sure that we're making the most impact with the least amount of money, is something I'm very used to doing. I also work in communications. I mean, the essence of communications is being able to build a coalition around an idea and to share that and to get people to be a part of that. I think that makes me a skilled negotiator and a skilled legislator. And so I'm really excited about for the opportunity to be able to apply that in state government.
Lee Snodgrass of Appleton is a Democratic candidate in the 57th Assembly District. The election is November 3. Lee, thank you for visiting with Wisconsin Eye.
It's always a pleasure. Thanks for having me again.
Thank you.
Campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.